Can you all hear me okay? I think that's on. Terrific. Well, first of all, many thanks to DASRA for putting on a fabulous conference today. It's really a terrific opportunity to get people together to discuss a lot of really important topics around how to advance philanthropy in India. I also, I've had, as mentioned, we've been able to support DASRA in the past, and I can't say what fabulous work you guys are doing on the ground in India. And really, I think everybody who cares about philanthropy in India really has a debt of gratitude to DASRA for the terrific work they're doing in broadly advancing the field. And this is just but one example. So just by way of quick background before we get into the panel, my name is Matt Bannock. I'm the managing partner at the Omidyar Network. And we invest early stage in organizations, both for-profit and not-for-profit, that we feel can scale up and have a huge social impact. So think of us as a philanthropic VC that does both for-profit and not-for-profit. In the last 10 years or so, we have deployed about $850 million of capital, and about $160 million of that has been in India. We've had a presence in India now for 4 or 5 years. Our original leader there is Jayant Sinha. And I'd like to be able to take credit for Jayant now being a minister in the Indian government, although I suspect he wouldn't let me do so. We now are led by a terrific woman named Rupa Kudva. Rupa was a CEO for many years of CRISIL, which is a credit rating agency in India. And as Jayant said, we're going from strength to strength with our leadership there. We have probably our outside of Silicon Valley. India is, in fact, our biggest office. And we like working there because there are so many opportunities. There's opportunities in terms of some real societal challenges where we think that smart capital invested behind great social entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs can have a big effect. We also think there's a ton of opportunity because the talent pool is so deep and rich and the spirit of innovation is so strong. So we see a number of combination of things that come together for us in India that really make us quite excited to be deeply engaged there. I have a fabulous panel today, and I'm gonna launch in. We're gonna have a couple questions. I'm gonna ask each of the panelists a question, and then we're gonna have a couple specific questions, then we're gonna have a couple general questions. Then we'll go to the audience, and it's going to go pretty quickly here. So I'll start with you, Maya. So Elevar Equity invests early stage in businesses that you believe can have a social impact and also can generate financial returns, and you're the co-founder. You're now on your third fund, and obviously you don't get to your second without having a very successful first fund, and you'll get to the third without having a very successful first and second. So what is here's the first softball question for Maya. What is the secret of your success?
thank you, Matt, and thank you to the folks at DASRA for all the good work that you do. Elevar is a venture capital fund, but we only invest in companies that are providing core essential services to low-income communities. We are today about 75-80% India focused. We have about 20% and growing in Latin America, which happens to be where our team is from. And the first key to our success, if you will, but it's early days, so I won't call it a success just yet, is being from our markets and knowing our markets. So at Elevar, not dissimilar to Omidyar, our largest office is in Bangalore. We have 10 people, folks from grew up, born, bred, careers, educations in India. A lot of them had exposure outside of India as well, mostly in the finance space. And knowing our market, being from the market, speaking the local cultural context, but very importantly for our work in particular, understanding the low-income communities. My colleagues and I have a love for walking around rural India, walking around the poorer neighborhoods and the urban centers, and understanding what people want and need. And the core of our understanding of the needs of the poor, where commercial opportunities are possible, and what business models might work, and then matching that to great entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs in our case who were among the founding team of Citibank India, who were at ICICI, who were at Unilever, who grew up in all of these great organizations, but then decided in their mid-40s or early 50s to say,
I want to build a phenomenal business serving the mass community in India that is so poorly served. That's the key to our success.
Terrific. Thank you, Maya. Lisa, you and Charlie have been active in India for quite some time, and including on the board of Tasra. You've also been active in other regions around, in the world. What, in your experience, sort of differentiates India from the other markets in which you're engaged?
Thank you for that question, but I want to actually say something before I launch in. And you would be the kind of person I would invest in as an impact investor.
I think we would all invest.
Yeah. And they all have.
Yes. Fund three.
Yes. And the reason for that is some of the things that we see that differentiate India from other geographies that we're working in. And let me start with why we even showed up in the first place. So when we graduated from the philanthropy workshop, we wanted to do an accelerator, or we thought that it would be great to take the GSBI idea outside of Silicon Valley, do it in situ, where there was a lot of deal flow, where we could experiment with the process. And we did a global study, and guess what showed up? India. Because there's a vibrant deal flow, there are tremendous challenges on the basic needs arena, and well-educated, English-speaking. There are a lot of things that really recommended India as a place for us to go and take our small capital. We have small philanthropic capital, with the idea that we could probably have a big impact. And you know, a lot of the ideas we're going to be talking about, I've heard echoed in the previous panel. So it's a tough working environment. We showed up. It was it takes a while to let India get a little under your skin, because it's very easy to get emotional. I think as a woman, as a mother, there's a lot about India that is broken. But there's a lot about it that is fixable and is being fixed by the Indians and by folks like us who are entering the space. Other challenges that are different, I think, about India than other geographies that we invest in would be the caste system. Caste system still plays a huge role today. A lot of dialects, a lot of customs. It's a big country. One size doesn't fit all. A lot of people think India, one India. No, India is a vast, very diverse country. But guess what? In that diversity, that's where opportunity exists. So back to the reason why we entered was because of the vibrant deal flow that we saw. And I'm going to give you an example, healthcare. So if you're an impact investor globally and you want to go somewhere where you're going to see 20 different ways of slicing that particular problem, go to India. Because you're going to see 20 plus in different geographies dealing with different issues, and you can learn from that. And if you want a front row seat, you become an impact investor, invest in it, take that front row seat, learn what worked, what didn't, and then hopefully take that model somewhere else. So that would be why we entered. Other things that we see that are quite different and challenging, I heard a lot of challenges that I would underscore. Regulatory framework, very tough for an impact investor. It's dynamic, it's ever-changing. So guess what? You need a trusted intermediary, someone with boots on the ground. But who is versed in both what is India and Indian and West and the Western philosophy and culture, because it's that combination that, as an impact investor coming from the outside, I need you to be able to communicate to me what's going on the ground, but I also need I need someone who can communicate to the style that I'm used to as an investor. You have to have a trusted intermediary group as well that can represent. We're small investors, so when we go and find a single deal that we want to invest in, it's very tough to, it might cost us, you know, five times to manage it than what we actually originally invested in it, and that doesn't make sense. And so then you start attaching yourself to networks, and that's one other reason why India is so unique, is that there's a lot of interest in India as this innovation hub where you can discover solutions to problems, frankly, that are all a global set of problems for almost every developing country on the planet. And so we've established our network of peers in India that we go to get resources. And I'm just going to name a couple of them. And they are just part of a growing community of resources. Ankur Capital in Bombay, for instance. Eva Yazari with Beyond Capital. She has a group of attorneys, global attorneys, that she provides pro bono. So if you're doing a deal and we're part of the network with her, she will lend those legal resources to help us cut the cost of legal scrutiny on a deal, and that's hugely helpful. Last year alone, I think that they utilized $350,000 worth of pro bono legal time to do deals in India. And then there's another gal, Audrey Stellian with Artha out of Geneva. She's got a really cool platform with 130 companies all profiled. So if I'm doing due diligence on a deal, I just go to her platform, skip through, look for this sector, and I can start to compare and contrast the deal that I'm looking at to see if it's investable. And you don't have that in other geographies because there isn't that, back to the vibrant deal flow and the quantity. That's what makes a difference for me ultimately as an impact investor in India.
Terrific. Thank you, Lisa. Now, Charlie, and you and Lisa have been active in impact investing for some time. And a lot of people just do the investing. You guys are also more broadly concerned about building the field, right? So you established this organization called Tonic, which provides a vehicle for people to get started in the realm of impact investing. And you now are leading this this effort, Charlie, called 100% In, and Lisa. Tell us a little bit about that effort and why that's important to you.
Great, well, thank you. I'm thrilled to be here this afternoon with many friends and remembering India and the global challenges that we all face. And I want to start out with a story about Neera and Devil that goes back about 10 years, if not 11. And so when we first started working in Hyderabad on this incubator accelerator called Social Impact International, I desperately tried to find partners in India, right? And we did a couple of false starts with Indians who just really, at that point in time, did not get the entrepreneurial nature of what we're trying to do and the flexibility necessary to bridge the gap between the not-for-profit sector and the for-profit sector. And we were thrilled when we ran into Deval and Neera in 2006-07 because they understood. And so I said, why don't you run this program, right? And they said, okay, after some negotiation, they didn't really just take it on, right? But then they did such a great job that we decided to just put the control all over, you know, them, DASRA Social Impact, and it became arguably one of the very successful incubators, accelerators in India, where I think we had 135 graduates, among them Husk Power Systems, BioLite, really successful social entrepreneurs, where we started to break down the barriers between the not-for-profit sector and the for-profit sector, between pure philanthropy and pure for-profit maximization. I'm very, very proud of the achievements that we did together in really trying to figure out how to maximize impact, not how to maximize philanthropy dollars, not how to maximize profits, but impact by using everything that that we have at our disposal. So Lisa and my travel in impact then led us, as you point out, Matt, to share our story about our investments, including the Indian investments, with our peers. And that led us to create a global organization of impact investors 5 years ago called Tonic. And Tonic is a global organization of active impact investors.
Well, question, yeah. Did it come after the gin, then the tonic, or the tonic and then the gin?
It just came after the gin, but okay. 1 year after the okay. gin.
So
and since you ask, you know, Lisa and I, we also created a twist.
Oh, okay. Ah. I see a theme, yes.
But with a double I, of okay. course, right?
So. It's a sidecar yeah. fund that we have.
And so Tonic caters, you know, to all types of active impact investors, be that beginners or advanced folks, be that impact-focused or financial-focused, be that investors who start out with investing in small social enterprises or portfolios or whole portfolios. And that led us to the 100% Impact Network, which is part of Tonic now. And these are investors who have intentionally committed 100% of their investable assets to positive impact. And so it has been phenomenal in the last 2 years how much that has grown. We thought initially that there would be maybe 24 of us, and now we are about 80 asset owners, from 1 million in assets to 1 billion in assets. From Australia to Hong Kong to Singapore, we'll talk about India in a second, to the Middle East, to Austria, to Europe, and to North America. From family offices to high net worth individuals to ultra high net worth individuals to endowments to foundations. And what ties us together is that deep desire for systemic impact. That's why we're going all in. And we don't take any hedges anymore, right? Because we put everything on the line. And across the portfolio, meaning across all asset classes, in cash, in equities, in fixed income, in private equity. We don't know about alternative assets. We haven't found really hedge funds that are right up our alley, but we're working with some, right, to do that. And of course, with real assets. And what let me end my initial remarks with where I think that the opportunity with India lies in the context of these global networks. So our theory of change, Lisa and my theory of change, is that we actually need to change the financial system in order to make it more aligned with the challenges of learning how to live within the caring constraints of a finitely resourced planet, sustainability, right? And the financial system is really at the core of that fundamental transformation that's going on over the next few years. And impact investing is the leverage point that we have identified to actually initiate that change. And the way that we work globally is with the leaders in these regions. So what we're looking for today or tomorrow or next month or next quarter or next year is the Indian leadership that will step up to the challenge of changing the financial system with us on a global scale. It has worked in Australia with Danny Almagor and Barry Lieberman. It has worked very successfully in Germany with Jochen Wermuth and his wife Sasha. It has worked extremely successfully in the UK with James Perry and his whole foundation and his ecosystem there. So what we need is the courageous people who step up and don't believe in the current story that either philanthropy alone or maximizing profits alone is actually sufficient to change the system in India and the globe. What we offer you, if you find these people or you are that person, is the connectivity to the global system. There's 80 of us going to 160 of us, $4 billion committed today, $1.5 billion invested right now, going to an order of magnitude larger. So my vision for you and us and the ecosystem at large is that we together imagine that future of collaboration, trust, changing the system to more sustainability, and then working towards that in the context of DASRA, in the context of Omidyar, in the context of impact investing, in the context of philanthropy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Woohoo.
By the way, I suppose that given that relatively few people, maybe it's an immodest or a modest crew, said you actually knew of impact investing. Just to clarify, our definition, working definition of impact investing is investing with the intent to drive social impact alongside financial returns. So that's the working definition. By the way, the Omidyar Network's journey in impact investing started about a decade ago. Pierre Omidyar, who made a lot of money through founding eBay, had quickly committed the lion's share of his wealth to the betterment of humankind. He started out with the Omidyar Family Foundation. So setting up a foundation, giving away money to well-intended, well-designed not-for-profits. He became frustrated because he said, okay, I'm doing some good over here, but why is it that my biggest impact I had in the world in terms of social impact was creating a business, yet people assume that the only way you can have positive social impact is giving money away? So we went from the Omidyar Family Foundation to the Omidyar Network. For those of you who are following acronyms, it went from off to on. and we've been deeply committed. By the way, my other reference to gin and tonic, there actually is an organization out there called the Global Impact Investing Network, mm-hmm. or GIN. So that was the reference to the gin and tonic. So we're balanced out here. Now, I want to get to the question, so I'll ask each of you, and I guess the Kleisners get two comments in here, to describe your work through the lens of one of your investments. And as you're doing that, also do that in the context of how you think about impact, risk, and return. Those three, how do you think about those three elements together? And what's a good example of your philosophy and your approach?
I'll pick one of our more recent investments, which straddles financial services and education. And Omidyar is actually a co-investor with us in this company. This is a company that is providing loans to affordable private schools, which are the schools that have been set up by education entrepreneurs in India that are serving low-income children from low-income families. So they charge tuition of anywhere from roughly $4 a month to $15 towards $20 for the more high school equivalent grades. And these institutions are providing a far superior education, for the most part, to low-income children whose only other alternative is the public schools, which oftentimes in India, teachers won't show up, the resources are abysmal, and basically the education is poor at best. And so this is something that families who want their children to achieve a better result than them, so these would be children of garment workers, children of agricultural workers, labor or informal enterprises, they want their children to learn English, get good mathematics and science, which are really the classes that are emphasized at these schools, and get a better, more secure, less hand-to-mouth job than what they have. These schools are very strapped for cash. They cannot improve their classroom infrastructure. They can't build a second story. They cannot build bathrooms for girls because banks won't lend to them. They need $5,000 to $25,000 loans, which is too small for the banks to attend to, and are too big for microfinance institutions to attend to. So the company we invested in, Vartana, is providing loans to these schools. But the founders of Vartana, their objective was not to build a financial services specialty business serving schools. Their objective was to transform education for lower income children in India. And they realized that given all of the fragmentation in India, the best way to reach the schools, to establish a relationship with the schools was through financial services, which is an immediate need for any entrepreneur. And once they've established that relationship, they want to use the channel that they've created to extend more services. So in many ways, this sort of encapsulates the way that we look at the world, which is we find phenomenal entrepreneurs who have a terrific sense of the market that they want to invest in, that they want to serve, and who are innovative about their approach. They wanted to transform education. They knew that the best way to do this would be to tap into a bunch of schools in India. Within just 3 years, they have reached about 1,000 plus schools, which serve more than 500,000 children, which is, in the India context, a drop in a bucket, but it's a great start. They will create impact by enabling schools to build facilities, buy desks, invest in technology, and eventually have access to a whole range of educational services that they may not otherwise have access to. So great entrepreneur, great business model, huge need, huge impact. If the business does well, it's because the children themselves are benefiting, because the Indian parents are fairly discriminating and they want to send their kids to the schools where the teaching should be better, where the infrastructure is better, where there are school buses, where there are desks. So I think this one story of this one company really brings the two sides of what we do together in terms of what I'll call the entrepreneurial opportunity, which is a commercial opportunity, with the impact opportunity.
Thank you, Maya. And we're running a little bit behind time because we want to get to the Q&A. So the Kleisners have generously agreed to once again in their lives combine efforts here and share. And the mic goes to Lisa, I guess.
Okay. Here we go. I'm gonna use an example from Dasra, actually. So we invested in two different businesses that came out of almost the same cohort. One is BioLite and the other is SMB Wills. And this will very briefly demonstrate risk, return, and what was the last piece? And impact.
Impact.
So one of them, SMV, is definitely high on the impact. It's an amazing deal where there's really direct hit to improving the lives of rickshaw pullers. BioLite, and this is in a very hard, tough part of India to actually do business, Varanasi. The other business, a New York young man, came out to India because this was his target market, so he went through Dasra. I mean, makes a lot of sense. And so he created a business that created two channels. One created a product for the recreational market, and then he retooled that for the developing market. It's a cook stove. And he's done much more since then as a cook stove that generates electricity. So in terms of as an investor, early days for me, I fell in love with the rickshaw deal, absolute passion love. I didn't look so much at the financial and other pieces and parts of it. And so, and so there's a risk there because I fell in love with the impact that it was having and didn't scrutinize the business enough. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the returns are high on the impact and low on the financial returns. On the other one, BioLite, basically it was de-risked because you had these two channels, one that was going to support the other, and he could toggle switch between the two and also get grants to support the developing world side. So, anyway, I hope that demonstrates how, as an impact investor, you can actually, in our portfolio, we purposely invest in things that are high on the impact and other ones that might be more moderate on impact.
Terrific, thank you. And just quickly on ON, we are centered on impact, right? And then we will invest across the risk returns continuum in service of impact. And we'll invest in businesses that generate a high return because not only do they have the direct impact, but then they can scale and attract additional capital. We'll also take more risk or be willing to accept lower return if we think that organization is not only going to have a significant direct impact, but if they can de-risk an entire sector, right? So they can be pioneering a new sector so others that can come along can figure out how to work the business model so they can scale, mm-hmm. right? So that's sort of some elements of how we think about it. We've just published something called a Frontier Capital Report. I think each of you, or there's at least one copy on each of the desks. And this is our attempt to look at what we have learned in our 10 years of investing in low and low middle income markets in the emerging markets. And we segment the market into three segments. One in which we call adapting models that have worked, typically technology models that have worked in wealthier countries and adapting them into an emerging market context. That is typically the realm where you see typical venture capital engaging. And so that market is off and running. One example of an investment we've made in India in that realm is Quikr, which is an online classified site. There's a second market we call a frontier market, which is markets that are being, where there's not necessarily a model that's been successful elsewhere, but where an entrepreneur is innovating locally based on local conditions and local demand. There's a company we invested in called Daily Hunt that does mobile publishing of books and news in 12 different languages and now has more than 80 million subscribers in India and is just hitting the knee of the curve, so to speak. And then the third segment we talk about in here is the Frontier Plus segment, where we feel that there are models that are not necessarily tech-enabled that require more cash, where there's a need for not only innovative business models, but innovative financiers who are willing to take greater risk or accept lower return in order to pioneer an entire new market. So I encourage you, if you want to learn a little more about one perspective on what organization has learned in investing in low-income goods and services for emerging markets, please grab a copy. With that, I think I'd like to open it up to some Q&A. Yes, and do we have a microphone? Yes.
So my question is around organizational structure and a potential additional lever to bring this major change. So I'm part of a group of people who are ambitious enough to believe that we can bring social mission primacy, sustainability, as well as inclusiveness into the DNA of corporate America, corporate world, and we are looking at, would it help to have policy change where we can have legal structures where this becomes part of fiduciary responsibility, where it's not just profit optimization? And I'm curious about, and we feel there's a fourth sector emerging in a sense, in addition to the three classic sectors, where there is impact investing, there is new forms of organization starting. There's need for legal infrastructure and org structure to make, for the millennials who want to have social mission primacy, make it easier. My question to the panel is, we're looking at India and US as the first countries to look at. In India, with the CSR change that is happening, is there an opportunity to leapfrog what CSR is here, like a siloed thing, which is either about branding or it's not the main focus of big corporations? Can one leverage that movement to bring sustainability, social mission, primacy, inclusiveness at a large scale in India? And especially with India having had a culture of thinking about society, the Gandhian movement, is that too ambitious, or do you all think that's possible? Just the way cell phone technology leapfrogged what we have in the West in India, coming in at the right time. Can one do that with the new CSR shift?
You want to take that?
Sure, I can start. I think the CSR movement outside of India is a marketing band-aid at best. So it really does not contribute significantly to any well-being. It does not contribute significantly to any sustainability, and it's a marketing effort. Now, in India, as you have pointed out, there is actually the beginning of potentially a different thinking, but they have to compete in the global marketplace as well, right? So I would say that I'm much more convinced that the off-balance sheet risk assessments of the multinationals are driving that agenda, and through the consumers and the investors, actually. So if the consumers start actually pointing out the risks in the supply chains and value chains that legally the multinationals are not held accountable for, right, but they are now reputationally, which will affect their shareholder price, that is the leverage point that we have. And I would not count on CSR at all.
Maya, did you want to?
Sure. I think that it's difficult. I think, as Charlie mentioned, there are some structures that exist here that are marketing speak or band-aids. There are some movements around B corporations and incorporating here in the U.S. with as part of your fiduciary responsibility, paying attention to all of your stakeholders. There are other movements that are important. And I would say that one of our learnings has been, and actually Matt can speak to this even better, is it is important to engage with the regulators, with the policymakers. There was a change to the definitions here in the US as to how pension funds should invest to open up considering social environmental good. As part of the data set. India can leapfrog. I would bet it's difficult because India has a lot of issues that maybe will grasp more attention, but I think it's important for there to be loud voices in society because the loud voices will shine a light on what's important to consider. So that would be my perspective.
It'll be fascinating. I think you're referring specifically to the 2% of profits that Indian firms are now committed to doing in corporate social responsibility. What I hear a lot of the times now is they don't know where to spend it. And this is where our friends at Tasra become so important, right? And in shining the light, I think that those pools of capital and the need to deploy those, the risk is they'll be, you know, people just want to push the money out the door. The opportunity is there are massive pools of capital. And if we have trusted intermediaries who can provide guidance to where that capital might be best served, and you have entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs who see that as an opportunity, I think it opens up potentially a new era of philanthropy and innovation in India. And it's all about how it plays out. And again, this is where having folks such as Dasra is going to be so, so important in the market. Other questions?
I have two questions. One on the impact side. Really curious about the rickshaw puller story. I'm from Calcutta and can relate a little bit in terms of what goes on there. And the second is, what kind of returns are we talking here, financial returns? Nobody talks numbers, so curious about that.
Sure.
So Lisa and I, we published with Sonen, our advisor, a report that analyzes the 7-year financial returns of our portfolio. And it includes 2008, 2009. And we have proven in that report, which you can download from our website or Sonen's website, that in every single asset class that we had competitive financial returns vis-a-vis industry accepted benchmarks in that asset class. So what that tells you is there's at least one portfolio on the planet that has shown that with the terminology of modern portfolio theory and the terminology of the accepted financial and analysts, right? Now, with the 100% Impact Network, actually, we have been embarking on showing that for 50 plus portfolios. And that report will come out through Tonic next year, where we show that all types of different types of portfolios, be that smaller portfolios, mid-sized portfolios, larger portfolios, be that portfolios that focus on poverty alleviation, that focus on climate change mitigation, that come from foundations or family offices, that we all have our approaches and our successes with respect to impact and return. To give you a concrete number, our foundation since 2001 has generated up until 2015 a year-over-year return of around 6% on average every year. And it's interesting, when we ask others, or when people say, well, that's not that much, right? And then we say, well, how did your portfolio do? We've never so far, and we're out there all the time, run into somebody who can say that they actually outperformed us over that time frame across the whole portfolio. Of course, you know, if you look into some asset classes just like we do, you know, we have more or less, right? But that is the impact portfolio of 100% portfolio that we have done. Moreover, a lot of impact investors would actually legitimately claim that impact investing is not a drag on financial performance, but it's actually an enhancer of financial performance. I mean, if you can actually predict, especially on the ecological side, on the green side, what will be internalized into the market, then you make a lot of money. On the social side, make no mistake, the market does not understand, you know, gives us no returns on that one. So that's where subsidized capital is actually necessary for some time to come, and that's where philanthropy capital plays a role. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any other comments? I had a few observations.
Just a quick, you know, our returns, if you look at top quartile VC, same vintage for our fund, it would be 16%. Our net IRR to our LPs is 24%. That's a real number.
That's private equity, huh?
Private equity, yeah. Exactly. And so, and you would have to look at it as part of a blended portfolio. Yeah. And I think what's very important, though, and I'm sure you'll report, we'll talk about this, you have to choose your fund managers well. Mm-hmm. So not everyone can deliver that. And not all impact themes mm-hmm. can deliver those kinds of returns, nor should they. So you need very thoughtful approaches to impact and to a blended portfolio.
I want to wanted to make one more comment, because we are always asked about proving our financial return, right? And I think we should ask the fund managers what their impact return is, not the other way around. And so because of this, together with NPC, Lisa and I, we have published through NPC our impact report, which actually complements the financial report and shows in a very innovative way the impact across the portfolio in each impact theme, to your point, which, you know, goes deeper or less deep, and for each investment.
Yeah. And you'll notice that Charlie and Lisa, their report is about three times thicker. Maybe there's three times the insight in there. We'll leave it to you to judge. One final comment on the whole returns thing. I have been to so many impact investing conversations where you have this, frankly, very stale and tiresome debate between people say, risk-adjusted returns, you gotta be risk-adjusted returns, you gotta be business-minded, you gotta demonstrate it works, you gotta always risk-adjusted returns, we get risk-adjusted returns, aren't we great? And they have people say, no, you can't be earning money off the poor, that's a terrible thing, you'll never get risk-adjusted returns if you really care and you invest early stage and blah, blah, blah. And if you know the individuals, they have different objectives, mm-hmm. right? There are gonna be times when you can generate risk-adjusted returns, when it's really important to generate risk-adjusted returns, to prove a model, to prove it works, to get scale, et cetera. There are other times when, I'm sorry, if you go towards the very base of the pyramid and people are earning $1, $2, $3, you ain't gonna get risk-adjusted returns.
No, that's right.
But you need to be centered on impact, right, in my view. Yeah. It's about impact. And then you have various tools that you can deploy to get that impact. Yep. So And at the Meteor Network, we invest across the continuum. So we make some investments where we say, yeah, we expect risk-adjusted returns here for these reasons. We have other investments say, you know what? If we get 1% or 2%, this will be a great investment because it's going to be stimulating a marketplace and others are going to replicate it and it's a really low-income market, blah, 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 blah. The key for us is discipline, right? For our investment professionals to come in and say, okay, here's the impact I'm going to get and here's how I'm going to measure it. And here's the financial return I'm going to get and here's how I'm going to measure it. Hold me accountable to that. So let's not distill it out into big number good, little number bad. Yep. It's about impact. And the different kinds of tools are all tools to generate the most positive social impact.
Yes, yes, yes. So, well, interesting thing about rickshaws, there's a global story and there's also an Indian story. And I don't think that this is one example where we looked at a lot of different models, and I don't think that anyone has solved it yet, because it sits exactly where Matt just described, in this area where you're working with the poorest of the poor. And there were great success stories in where rickshaw pullers were able to purchase their rickshaws. And actually, I met one man who was able to buy a house, and he bought another house. So he was making his way up financially and gathering assets. And that story, though, the problem with the whole business model is that when you're dealing with the lowest of the low earners, and it's a very tough environment, the repayment rate is incredibly low, so they cannot qualify. With the repayment rate being in somewhere around 60% or less, it's very tough to qualify for commercial capital. So then you end up in this cycle where you can't graduate them to be able to take on commercial capital, which is what we were trying to do. Also, if you go to a nonprofit model, the rickshaw players won't pay back the loans. Yeah. If you go to a pure for-profit, it's too expensive for them to pay it back. So you're stuck in this little middle zone here. And so just to my point, I've looked at rickshaw deals globally, and I still haven't found a good solution. But if anyone here knows of another business model tackling this, please let me know.
Now, did you still have a question? We had a question over here.
Good afternoon. I'm Janet Camarina, Director for Transparency Initiatives at Foundation Center. And depending on the audience, usually that title is either a conversation starter or ender. but along those lines of transparency, I've been thrilled and want to thank Dasra and this panel for focusing so much on data and trust. And I'm curious, as you said, deal flows, because Foundation Center has a couple of resources that could be really helpful to the conversation in this room and the donors around building trust. We have the washfunders.org platform and the SDG Funders platform that helps track who is funding what where, so that people can not necessarily shortcut due diligence, but at least learn from what other philanthropists are learning mm-hmm. in the service of many of the themes we are talking about here today. So my ears kind of perked up when you talked about deal flows, because in this space, I'm not sure what the transparency mechanisms are, and not so much for the return on the investment, as you've just said, but more on the impact. So if a donor were looking to scan the landscape in a particular country like you did, how would they know what you know? How can they learn from what you've learned about not just the rickshaw investment, but across the board, what is working and what isn't? Because it's less clear to me in the absence of 990s or an infrastructure organization like Foundation Center aggregating and then sharing it for free on a platform, what those mechanisms are for transparency.
Well, Tonic, in a word. So the Tonic network is global, and I can pick up the phone and talk to someone in Timbuktu, literally, and ask what the local transportation pricing looks like of an investor that's a peer of mine, and that's where I get the information. It's a great network because, in particular, this deal, which we're struggling with, I've leveraged resources in Bangalore, another similar type of business, where I had the CEO of that company work with the CEO of the company in Varanasi. So we're trying the best we can with the resources we have to learn from it and not give up on it, but try to find ways that we can do workarounds to enable these nascent seed stage enterprises to survive, and then hopefully thrive. So, but it, Tonic, in a word, is a super, super resource network that includes philanthropists, people who have grant capital that they're leveraging on one end of that spectrum, as well as seeking a market plus return on the other end of the spectrum, just like us.
So we call it radical transparency. So that's, you know, usually for us it's an opener of discussions, but it also means that you're willing, that you have to be willing to share, which by the way was a difficult proposal for the Indian market initially. So when Tanik came into India, right, and said we want to collaborate with all the angel networks in India, not only did they not trust us, but they also thought that we were competitors. And so it's, you know, it's the radical transparency is for many people a new concept and maybe a challenging concept, right? And but our model, you know, only works through transparency because to, I think Lisa's point, you know, if we do a $100,000 investment and it costs us $50,000 to do the due diligence and then you do $100,000 over there as well, you know, we actually aggregate capital because we are radically transparent and share on that level, and that makes it work. Otherwise, it would revert back to an old angel model, you know, where you have to go and visit everybody and jet around the planet to do the due diligence.
Just a couple comments, and I'm going to close with a final question to the panel. Comments on this. First of all, as proud supporters of Tonic, great resource.
Thank you.
There is also the Global Impact Investing Network, and that's more for-profit deals. In India, what the network DASR has is pretty incredible. I would also note that it's not just about finding the entrepreneurs and social entrepreneurs, it's about helping them scale, right? There's that human capital component that's really important. It's one thing to say that an entrepreneur or social entrepreneur is out there looking for funding. It's another one to say, really, do they have all the skills to scale up? One of the things we do at the Midyar Network is we have a whole set of resources dedicated to helping our portfolio organizations scale up. We offer recruiting services, where we offer performance, we come and work with them on performance management basis, a whole other things. And it's that sort of soft capital that we find is critically important. And then also creating a network is also extremely important. They will inevitably learn more from each other than they will from any individual. And so I'm going to actually be in Bangalore next month, where we're going to have our annual conference with all of our roughly 100 India-based organizations that we've supported. And that is an opportunity to get together and to share lessons learned and to help each other become more successful. So in addition to just finding the entrepreneurs, helping scale the entrepreneurs I think is critically important. So with for my panelists, as we close here, what can the audience members here do to drive positive social change in India? What are the kinds of things that anybody can engage with today or to get somebody who's interested in having that impact? How do you get started? How do you think about having an impact in India? Many of you already are, but just the...
I guess two things. One, obviously, you know, here in the Valley, there's access to a lot of technical knowledge, mentoring, entrepreneurs, but with the, respect that, you know, some of the conditions on the ground are quite different and that you can't just sort of pilot in from Silicon Valley and say, this is the way you need to do things. But there are a lot of entrepreneurs who are doing really, really, really hard work who love mentorship from other entrepreneurs and in particular from folks here in the Valley. So that's, you know, one concrete thing that can happen in terms of, you know, bridging the divide and, you know, working with DASRA, for example, to figure out who those social entrepreneurs are who could use some help is a huge plus.
I'm going to be controversial here. I actually think we need to elevate the conversation. It's not about philanthropy. It's about transforming the way we think about capital and poverty and giving people dignity. And until we're willing as asset owners and consumers to change our expectations and our value proposition vis-a-vis the market makers, we're, you know, the poor are semi-doomed. And so we've seen transformation in markets here in the U.S. We've seen it in Europe. I would love to see that same transformation in India.
You get the last word, Tom.
So I doubt it.
We'll see.
The 100 percenters go all in. And what that really means is they don't see their portfolio as an exercise of making money or having impact. They actually see their portfolio as an expression of the change that they want to see in the world. Yeah. Very different, right? They are not fear-driven of losing money. They're actually driven by the joy of making a positive contribution to the change that we need to do. And so my advice is, be the change.
You're here.
And
I tried to make it such that you don't have to.
I'm tempted to leave it there, but no, I think we really are at a very exciting stage. And my panelists and Dasra and so many people in this room, we're at this. We have these incredible innovators. We have a new set of tools. We have technology. We have innovation. We have a willingness to blend the previous distinctions between charity and business. I think we're poised in an era at a time where we truly can bring all these tools to bear to have a massive impact on some of what have seemingly been pretty intractable problems. And I think each of us, it's our role to figure out, you know, how we best apply our skills to make that happen. And with that final word, you sure you don't want it like?
I'm good.
Thank you all for your time and attention. Thank you, Dasra, again for hosting, and very much appreciate it. Thank you.